Hi, everyone. I'm Allison Mast, Chairman of the Investment Banking Division, and I'm delighted to be here today with my friend and client, Ken Mehlman, Global Head of Public Affairs and Co-Head of Global Impact at KKR. So Ken spent 12 years in national politics and government service, including as chairman of the Republican National Committee and campaign manager for President Bush's 2004 re-election campaign before joining KKR in 2008. So Ken, thank you so much for being here today.
Appreciate the opportunity.
So let's start at the beginning.
Yep.
You grew up in Pikesville, Maryland.
I did.
And from a very early age had an interest in politics. Rumor is that you were campaigning door to door for Ronald Reagan at age 14, well before you could vote, and you watch C-SPAN at night for fun. But
that's
we'll
exciting.
Talk about that later. But seriously, what piqued your interest in politics and the Republican Party from such a young age?
I'm not sure what it was that got me interested in politics specifically. Like a lot of people of my generation, of Generation X, if you look back and you study the history at that time, President Reagan was very popular. Why was that? I think it was the optimism that he exuded. He had a tremendous confidence in the country. He had a tremendous confidence in the future. And I think that it was ironic to a lot of people that this gentleman who, when he ran for president, was 69 years old, was so appealing to younger voters. But I think that politicians that have that optimism, President Obama had that, and he had a similar connection with younger voters.
So after Harvard Law School, you worked on Capitol Hill as a legislative director and then chief of staff. So what did you learn about politics in those early days that ultimately landed you the job as national field director for George W. Bush's 2000 presidential campaign?
When I first went to work for Governor Bush in 1999, there were about 30 of us. I had responsibility for the whole Midwest at the time. And the first state, as you all know from watching today's news, is Iowa. And I had responsibility for Iowa among the other states. And I went to Iowa. We had a great team in Iowa, but I was concerned that the plan wasn't exactly where it should be. And so I essentially moved to Iowa. And I said, I'm going to live in Iowa for the next several months. And I remember a colleague saying to me, why would you do that? Live in Austin. That's where the governor is. Get to know him. Why didn't you not have these other nine states you have responsibility for? And I said, because I don't want to be known by the governor. I want to win for the governor. And I ultimately was successful. We won Iowa, did very well, had a historic performance, and ultimately that individual ended up working for me.
Wow.
So, I mean, the lesson there is that, you know, what's the plural of focus? Loss of focus. And I had an opportunity for about 6 months to completely focus like a laser beam on one effort in one state. And we developed a pretty innovative approach around peer-to-peer outreach that was ahead of its time. It served me well, and the leadership of the campaign, starting with Governor Bush, liked it and said, let's apply this everywhere.
So after winning that campaign and the recount, you became director of the White House Office of Political Affairs. So how would you say that campaigning is different from governing?
It's very different, and it really also depends upon the particular president. If you remember back to 1999-2000, President Bush had made a real commitment to work in a very bipartisan way for a number of initiatives. The first was a law that at the time was called the No Child Left Behind Act. It was about education reform. For the first time ever, we actually measured how kids were doing. And very importantly, we disaggregated the data so that we fundamentally said, okay, in this district, people are improving, but are people of color improving? Are immigrants improving? Are people from a lower socioeconomic status improving? And by disaggregating the data, we were able to really provide need to people, help the people that needed it, and we were able to hold people accountable. That was something that was developed between John Boehner and Ted Kennedy and George W. Bush. And so a very different political effort behind that was required in terms of building a big bipartisan coalition. There was a similar effort around tax reform that was bipartisan. Then, tragically, September 11, 2001 happened, and I would say really for the rest of that year and much of the next year, the focus really turned much more to the war we were in. And the whole area of focus for our office and our domestic agenda changed.
So then in 2002, at the age of 35, President Bush asked you to run his reelection campaign. Can you talk about how that happened?
Sure. So one weekend, I get an invitation to go to Camp David, which was cool. I was like, yeah, I'll do that. And so I went there, and President Bush, I remember, I was talking to him and a secretary, Mel Martinez, who was our Secretary of Housing and Urban Development, and we were in front of a fireplace. And President Bush says to Mel Martinez, we were talking about something, and he said, someone commands an army. He said, Mehlman's about to command an army. And I was like, okay, that's cool. Hoping they're not sending me to Afghanistan. Fundamentally, he then had a conversation. He said, would you be interested in running the reelection campaign? Wow. And you know, if you think about it, so President Bush has a number of awesome advisors, people like Karen Hughes and Karl Rove and Dick Cheney, people that are a generation older than I am, people that have known him for a long time. And I recognize that. And I said to President Bush, look, you've got a lot of really top advisors who you've known for 20 years, who could be my dad's age. And I recognize they're going to be your top advisors. But for me to run this campaign, I need to really be in charge of the campaign. I can't have people that think they know better second-guessing, or the campaign is going to fail. So while your advisors are going to tell you what to do and are going to help be strategically driving everything we do, I need to be able to be in charge of the effort in the context of everybody that's hired and fired and every dollar we spend. And if I'm against it, even if your advisors are for it, we've got to do it. And he said to me, you're a good manager. And that was really important because, again, these were folks that had a longer relationship with him. And if you study politics, one of the things that bedevils so many campaigns, re-election and otherwise, is second-guessing among people that are like the kitchen cabinet of the political leader versus the individuals that are actually running it. And my concern was, given that, again, I was a generation younger than these folks, would I be in a place where I fundamentally had no ability to do what I needed to do to run the effort? And so that was a really important empowerment he gave me. And I was smart enough to understand I wasn't like out there bragging about I'm the guy, because I wasn't the guy. But I was in charge of the campaign. And having that authority was very important.
So you were then named chair of the Republican National Committee. One of the things you tried to do then and continue to do now is expand the base of the GOP. So you famously addressed the NAACP and apologized for the party's approach to race. What progress do you think has been made on that front? And what is your take on the state of the party's relationship with minority voters today?
So I think that was the most important thing I did the entire time I was in politics. And it was the most important because it was right. Fundamentally, if you think about, and by the way, I did two things in that speech. One, I explained and recognized and saluted the history of the Republican Party, a party that was founded by Abraham Lincoln and that have a long history of being in favor of racial reconciliation and progress. But I also noted that in recent years there had been too many that gave up on that, and that in fact in some cases benefited from political divisiveness along racial issues, which I think is as immoral as anything I can think of. So I thought it was a really important speech to give, and it wasn't more just a speech, it was a consistent effort to explain what our vision was and why our vision was important. The reality is that too many people in our country then and to this day, today, have less opportunity for lots of different reasons, one of which is those opportunities too often divide along race lines. And it seems to me that the reason I joined the Republican Party and the reason that Abraham Lincoln founded the party was to make sure the American dream could be available to everybody. And so laying out what that meant in terms of educational equity and what that meant in terms of making sure that we recognize that the job of our prison system, which has horrible differentiations along races, we fix that and we make that better. And recognizing the opportunity for people to start small businesses and realize their dreams is an agenda that we all should be for and we should be focused on. In terms of where are we, look, I think that obviously there's things that I'm proud of that both parties have done. I think the criminal justice reform law that recently was signed is a much bigger deal than it gets credit for. That's a huge thing. And dealing with what is a bipartisan tragedy, which was mass incarceration, which had horrific effects in many communities of color and in many communities where people have less economic power, where essentially we made it illegal to be an adolescent boy, where young men who did things that a lot of us did when we were growing up end up in jail, and kids in the suburbs don't end up in jail. That's a ridiculous situation. And we still deal with it in a massive way. And so that's progress. I still think, though, that the opportunity divide is much too great in the country. And I think that we need to massively recommit ourselves to things like a focus on educational equity and making sure that everybody has more access to opportunity. And I think it's also very important that we appreciate and understand how different communities experience different things, and leaders need to bring people together.
So you're now co-head of the KKR Global Impact,
yes,
which launched in 2018. To put a focus on investing in what KKR calls solutions-oriented businesses.
Yep.
But what were the initial goals of the Global Impact Fund and how they evolved over the last couple of years as more and more companies have entered the space?
So essentially, the way we moved into this space is over the last 10 years across a lot of our different private equity and infrastructure products, we've invested in companies that were dealing with problems that both were commercially important but also societally important. So we've been very large investors in green energy for the last 10 to 12 years. Big investors in water, lots of different companies, in municipal water systems, in water metering systems, in companies that deal with wastewater treatment. We've been very significant investors in responsible food production in China and in Southeast Asia. Big investors in workforce development related companies. And what we learned in all these companies is that if you're disciplined in how you invest, you can achieve private equity returns. What we also learned was there's an even greater number of companies in those same thematic areas in the lower middle market. Companies where you're writing smaller equity checks of $50, $70, $80 million. And what we concluded was, given that we have experience with these sectors and themes, why not create a strategy that is a lower middle market strategy entirely comprised of companies around these same themes that align with the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals? That's how we developed the strategy. We've raised $1.3 billion. We've made about six investments, and there are some incredibly cool companies that you're getting to work with.
That's great. So one major focus for you, of course, is sustainability.
Yeah.
And it's a major focus for us at Goldman Sachs as well. But what, in your opinion, is the investment case to be made for focusing on sustainability?
So if we were sitting here 25 years ago, and I said to you, demographics and the retirement of the baby boomers, and as a result, I'm going to create a strategy around things like senior housing and nursing homes and assisted living, and you had invested in it, you would have done really well, because that is a giant demographic tailwind. So consider the following. There's 1 billion to 1.5 billion people in Asia and other places, but there is a large Asian population that have parents who were essentially very poor and who are now middle class. So if you go from not knowing whether you'll eat to knowing you're going to eat, all of a sudden you care about what's in your food and what's in your air and what's in your water and how waste is managed. And so that's an investment trend that even if you didn't care about the UN SDGs, you'd want to invest behind. There are an estimated 375 million people in this country who between now and 2030 won't just have their particular job disrupted, they'll have their entire career disrupted. If you can invest in the companies that are using labor market data analytics to figure out what are going to be the jobs and skills of the future, you're going to have a great investment opportunity. And so you look at some of these themes we're talking about, in our case, clean water, adapting and mitigating to climate change, helping deal with a responsible use of waste, ag tech, workforce development, industrial innovation to make workplaces safer, make us more mobile, and make all of our lives more sustainable. These are things that have not just an alliance with the UN SDGs. They don't just contribute to the SDGs. They are being driven by very consequential demographic trends and other trends. And so to me, that's the investment case for it.
So I'm curious what the reaction from your investors has been in this focus on sustainability and how that informs your long-term outlook on the topic. Are they really engaged? Do they care?
They are. They're very interested in this space. I think we were very pleased by the investor interest and demand for the strategy. But look, we have an obligation, in my opinion. What the investors have done by supporting this effort is give us an opportunity and an obligation. The obligation is to do two things. One, to invest in a thoughtful, smart way that provides the risk-adjusted returns they're expecting. And second is to be impact authentic. Second is to make sure these are genuine impact investments, that when people look at it and they look at how we're reporting and measuring, they understand it, and to be overly transparent and disclosive with respect to how we view those particular investments. Both of those things are obligations we have. These are areas where I think there's a tremendous opportunity, but I think people who are in this space, all of us have an obligation to make sure that we're doing it in an incredibly responsible and an incredibly authentic and aligned way.
So you've talked a little about this, but politics clearly plays a role in our response to climate change. And how has your extensive political experience helped you navigate this growing focus? And it's arguably new to a lot of the investors.
So look, I think that politics is a lagging indicator. And it's true in so many contexts. And I think that the things that people see on their televisions every night about what happened in Australia earlier this year and in California, which was not only a human tragedy, but an ecological disaster, the amount of crazy storms we've had in much of the United States and unique rain events remind people that climate change is a really existential and critical challenge that we have to address. And so I think what we have an obligation and an opportunity to do is to say, how do we think about that when deciding where to invest? And how do we think about that when deciding how our companies operate? And I think that's something that we all need to do. And while obviously you want to make sure you're absolutely following the law, you also want to look and you have to say where the world is heading.
So, speaking of politics, given we're in the thick of a presidential election year, I do want to get your perspectives on the current state of the race.
Yep.
What forces do you think are going to be most important as voters head to the polls, both during the primary season and in the general election?
So I would, just a few points. We tend to focus a lot on what we're seeing right in front of us. Since 2015, almost every election that has occurred around the world has been, not in every case, but in almost every case, won by the insurgent, by whatever the leader of the party is or the force is that can argue they're an insurgent force and they're going to represent change. Why is that? I think there are a number of factors. One, I think industrial revolutions produce political revolutions. Study the late 1800s. People are being disrupted in an unprecedented degree in their jobs. That creates a tremendous level of anxiety, which fuels populism. Second, the effect of social media and the internet, I think, is as big an event as the invention of the printing press. The printing press, all of a sudden, average people knew what previously sovereigns and popes knew, and they were really upset. It led to political revolution then. It led to the Reformation. It led to scientific revolutions. Now, any individual, whether that be the NBC News president or somebody whose iPhone is on when someone's removed from a United airliner, can broadcast in a way that the whole world can see. And the effect of that is incredibly revolutionary in terms of how it essentially diminishes the credibility of almost every institution and every institutional leader. That reinforces populism. Third, there are very significant demographic changes occurring in the United States and Europe. Again, study history, that always combines with populism. And so those factors together mean that we're in a very populist environment, and I think you see that in the political parties. What would I say in terms of watching? I'd say ignore the noise and pay attention to the signal. This election, remember this, is likely to be decided by 300,000 people in seven states. 300,000 people total, maybe 400,000 in seven states, are going to decide the election. So paying attention to what those individuals are likely thinking is really important. Who are the volatile voters? Who are the people that voted for President Obama and then for President Trump and then voted Democrat in 2018? It's a combination of, one, voters in the suburbs, and second, voters that historically were the core of the Democratic Party, but are more populist in their economic outlook, often a lot of these voters in the upper Midwest. So I would say focus on those particular trends. And then the last point I would say is, remember the metrics change. So I remember people looking back in 2016 and laughing because one of President Trump's advisors said, don't pay attention to cash on hand, pay attention to number of yard signs and social media followers. It was Kellyanne Conway. She was right. And so, again, don't pay attention to how we measured success in previous models. Pay attention to where people are getting information and learning today.
All right, so one issue that might not be getting enough attention is LGBT rights.
Yep.
And you made major news a decade ago when you came out as gay and became a major force behind marriage equality. And one of the things that I'd be very interested in hearing, and I know the audience would as well, is as you think back to 2010, like, what was that moment like when you walked into Henry Kravis's office to tell him that you wanted to announce this to the world and use your voice to advocate for marriage equality?
So it's a really important story to me for a lot of reasons. And one is it tells you so much about Henry Kravis and who he is. So I went into his office, and I was on the board at the time of an organization called AFER, the American Foundation for Equal Rights. And we were an organization that had hired Ted Olson and David Boies to challenge Prop 8 in California. The thesis was that a lawsuit is often a very good way to tell a story, and that having these very famous, previously opposing counsel, both very talented, could be a good way to do that. And we had a fundraiser scheduled in New York that was turned out to be a really good event. And I was the host of it. And so this was about to be very newsworthy. And so I went in and told Henry, I said, I'm gay, and I'm going to be involved in this effort. And Henry was as supportive as he could be, incredibly kind. And he said to me the following. He said, Ken, tell me about the event. And I told him about it. And he said, how much money do I have to give you? You fill the check out as long as I get my name on the invitation.
Wow.
And the amount of what that meant to me, I can't even begin to express. The amount of loyalty that built is impossible to gauge. And it wasn't just Henry. Our Scott Nuttall, who's a co-president of the firm, and his wife asked me to put their name on the invitation. I mean, you don't usually get people to ask you to give them a check for something, and they did. And there's a bunch of examples like that within the firm, and it made a huge difference to me, and it was something that I will always cherish and appreciate.
It's a great story. Okay, last question is, the best piece of advice you've ever received from someone else that you would want to leave this audience with?
So when I was in law school, I was a summer associate, and there was a summer event, and one of the guys I worked with, I said, it's a summer event. He said, it's a firm event, and I said, what should we wear? And he said, well, the summer associates can wear a golf shirt and khaki pants. And I said, what are you going to wear? And he said, I want to wear a suit. And I said, what should I wear? And he goes, well, what do you want to do? And the advice I took from that was, dress for the job you want, not the job you have. And it's not just dress. Think about it. If you go to any situation and don't say what's expected of me, say what do I hope to be able to produce. And that affects not only how you address it affects how you comport yourself. It affects how you prepare. It affects how you think about your role. And if you do it in a way that's not obnoxious and not like ridiculous ambitious, but simply says, I'm going to acquit myself the way I want to ultimately be in terms of my professional or other role, I feel like that's a pretty good way to live.
That's great advice. So it's a great way to end.
Thank you.
Please join me in thanking Ken for being with us today.
Thank you.
That's great.